On October the 31st, 1517, Martin Luther posted 95 big questions which he believed faced the church of his day to a local church door in Wittenberg, Germany. 500 years later, I decided to post 95 new questions, one a week, to the web, questions which I believe the church must face in the 21st century. God's appearance changes. Blessed are those who can recognise God in any disguise, says an old proverb. I've commented before that it's a really sobering fact to recognise that the only groups that Jesus ever chose to seriously critique were those who included themselves and yet excluded others from the always given welcome and embrace of God. The religious and community leaders of Jesus' day were far from inclusive. Theirs was a culture littered with outcasts. They were accomplished at using their distorted understanding of God to underpin the repressive social hierarchy that they created, which at one and the same time put them at the centre of everything and legitimised their exclusion of others. As far as the Jewish hierarchy were concerned, things were clear-cut. People were either acceptable or unacceptable, clean or unclean, in or out, included or excluded. It was black and white. There was no middle ground. The physically disabled, tax collectors, slaves, shepherds, people with leprosy, prostitutes, Romans and all other non-Jews, and to a large degree all women, were considered beyond the pale. And every day, every devout male Jew in Jesus' culture would recite 13 ancient blessings as part of their morning prayer, which included these clauses. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has not made me a Gentile. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has not made me a slave. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has not made me a woman. The religious establishment had reduced God to nothing more than their own tribal, racist, oppressive, and sexist deity. Good news for them and for those who thought like them, but not for anyone else. What they'd failed to recognise is that when it turns out that God disapproves of all the people you disapprove of, you can safely conclude that what you've actually done is fallen into the trap of recreating the Creator in your own image. Jesus upset the Jewish authorities because he presented a vision of God far bigger than their misconceptions. The God he spoke of was far more generous than theirs, far more inclusive than theirs, far more reckless than theirs, extending mercy to all people regardless, rather than just those deemed good enough, religious enough, healthy enough, or orthodox enough to be acceptable. For the last few weeks, we've spent our time looking at Jesus' response to the Pharisees when they got together to try to pin him down on which of the Hebrew Bible's Ten Commandments he thought should be regarded as the most important. His reply is well known. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind, and love your neighbour as yourself. I've explained that what Jesus does, in my view, is what Richard Rohr calls thin slice the old Hebrew text to find the sentences which identify that the core of it all is love. So ignoring the Ten Commandments altogether, instead he pulls together two what the Pharisees would have regarded as random texts, one from Deuteronomy chapter 6 and the second from the book of Leviticus chapter 19, and then he presents them as the greatest commandments on which all the other law as well as the prophets hang. Now, people often get in touch with me to remind me, sometimes rather angrily, that Jesus didn't come to abolish any of the law, as they assume I'm suggesting, but instead to fulfill it. And they point out to me that Jesus also warned in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 5, that until heaven and earth disappear, not the smallest letter, not the least stroke of a pen of the law will disappear. So let me explain. In my view, although they're right about their first conclusion that Jesus' intention wasn't to abolish the law, they're wrong about the second, about my view that he had come to do this. Instead, I'm convinced that what Jesus was suggesting was that the entire Old Testament law, with a capital L, should be capable of being summed up or fulfilled as love, because God is love. And that therefore any individual law with a small l that in any way sought to justify exclusion was always misguided. And although I know that this still won't satisfy some, here comes the bombshell for anyone who wants to take the Bible seriously. Paul, Jesus' follower and author of much of the New Testament, often understood, wrongly in my view, to be a huge legalist, but we'll come to that in the coming months, when he is writing to the young churches in Galatia, has this to say. You can read it for yourself in Galatians chapter 5, verse 14. Here it comes. Are you ready? For the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command. Love your neighbour as yourself. So for all those who read the New Testament in a legalistic way, this causes multiple problems. First, just like Jesus, Paul spoke of fulfilling the entire law through love, whilst, as we know, at the same time arguing very strongly that much of the Old Testament written law, for instance, all the bits about circumcision, the Jewish purity laws, the food laws, and much more, were irrelevant to most of humanity, the Gentiles, and of no value to the rest, the Jews. But secondly, here in his actual words, if understood in the same legalistic sense that some argue is the only way to understand the Bible, his words are out of sync with Jesus. Whilst Jesus insists there are two great commandments, Paul appears here to have reduced it to just one. Love your neighbour as yourself. And over the next few weeks, that's the one we're going to explore. Love your neighbour as yourself. But for now, I'll leave you with a question. I said that when it turns out that God disapproves of all the people you disapprove of, you can safely conclude that what you've actually done is fallen into the trap of recreating the Creator in your own image. Do you agree or disagree? And what does this mean for our society and for your local church?